paracetamol charge just now, and it's causing not just the throat but perhaps the brain to freeze. And I will just take forward some of the things that Mihir has said, Mukul has said, and I think you would have heard others from Ramjas College speaking. Firstly, a little, you know, in the last, from 2016 onwards, for me personally as a lawyer, I think there is almost like a new specialization in law that I could talk of, which is about students, professors, and all issues relating to universities. And I have seen from 2016 onwards, many of my friends then become clients in a sense. And I want to talk about some of those things. You may have heard some of that earlier, so if I'm repeating, please do stop me so that we don't waste time. On the aspect of criminalization and what Avinash and Mukul also said, I think that's exactly the point. The point is not that the law is going to be used to necessarily entangle you in long proceedings. That is also part of the story. But there is a more immediate and pointed purpose with which the law is being used, particularly criminal law is being used, and that is to both demonize the individual, vilify, vilify the institution, and to engineer and orchestrate hate against those persons. And that is why when we hear these testimonies from teachers and students, they talk about spine-chilling experiences, feeling under surveillance, because that is precisely the purpose with which the criminalization is done. I want to go back to three of these cases, well, cases in a legal sense, but I think very important incidents that have taken place, as having been personally part of them as a lawyer, starting from the 9th February 2016 JNU incident, which post that event, actually nobody even knew the event had happened, till Z News was kind enough to bring it to national attention through doctored videos and otherwise, and engineer hate. And that is what I'm saying. There is a plan, there is an entire process through which this hate is engineered, and law is deployed with full knowledge that there will be political patronage, that courts, public opinion can be manipulated and shaped. Well, courts, I'm not saying can be manipulated, but public opinion can be manipulated, and courts may be overawed by the public opinion. And I will just say, show why I say so. On the morning after when Karaya was to be produced, and he may well have spoken about it himself, there was a petition filed in the Supreme Court saying that on his production some security must be provided. The court listed the names of all of us as lawyers who will be allowed to be there, and the registrar of Delhi High Court was asked to make arrangements. When we were entering, we saw obviously a very large mob, and there had already been a precedent to this 2 days earlier when teachers had been attacked and journalists had been attacked. And those who were raising and were part of the mob were actually lawyers of that court or otherwise, it was hard to say. But the national flag and certain slogans, which nowadays seem to should actually sound as alarm bells for us, were very much present there. There was a lot of so-called police bandobast done. There were senior judges present. All of us were present. We did inform one of the senior most judges that the way in which it has been organized, even for those of us, we are not in charge of, we are not security planners. But if you're going to put me in the center and have the mob surround me, any person with common sense knows that this is a bad idea and can create trouble. And this was brought to their attention. When Kanhaiya came in, he was attacked. We saw the man who attacked him. The judicial officers and the police said they did not see him. Some of us did see him. How he was able to come in is not a mystery. Nobody that day could have walked in without an I card or permission from the police. So if he did walk in, there was not a breach of security. He was allowed to walk in. After which, again, the issue was raised by us that this is a very serious violation, including of the High Court order. I think it's important when we personally, you know, I've seen the 84 carnage against Sikhs in this city, and the only memory that it was bringing back of that kind of surrounding and sloganeering of lawyers and the mob was actually of what was happening in 84 in Delhi. Supreme Court had to rush in court commissioners. Why I'm saying all this? Because most of it is known to you. What happened after all this? Senior lawyers of the Supreme Court came as court commissioners because we reached out to them. Incidentally, all our cell phones were taken away, even of lawyers. It was only after the breach happened that some of us insisted that since the judicial officers and the police has failed to provide security, please return our phones, we have to reach out to our colleagues. At which point the Supreme Court was interrupted by Indra Jai Singh, Prashant Bhushan and others, and the senior lawyers came. They were attacked. They went back and reported. The next day there is a statement that I'm happy to place on record here because I don't even know if it's what the paper is written on. All of us lawyers who were present as Kanwars counsels in Patiala House that day gave a signed written statement to the bench headed by Justice Chalameshwar at that time to please take this in record and take action against those who had indulged in this. Justice Gogoi in January 2018 said that there is no reason to flog a dead horse and that this matter should now be put to an end, and if anybody wants to take up, go and access different remedies in the law, it's open to you. Why I'm telling this story is because this is how we first demonize individuals, institutions. We create a narrative. We are able, the state is able to then shape a certain public opinion. The only institution that can step in to curb this or to turn this the other way is the court. And if the court does not do that, then there is reason both to be worried and to repeatedly point out where these institutions have failed us. So the dead horse may not be flogged. I'm only curious who's the dead horse, you know, amongst all of us. I also want to just read out a portion of Justice Pratibha Rani's bail order when it was granted, while granting bail, because I think that when we say freedom of speech, etc., and I totally agree with what has been said by Mihir, because that's the only way we can argue and have a foundation on which to stand. But I think some of the, and I'm not even going to bother with the song that she began her bail order with, but I think we need to look at what is this demonizing and sedition and hate speech doing in all our midst. That becomes very important. The judge writes, I'm quoting from her bail order, "Today I find myself standing on a crossroad. The FIR in question has been registered only on 11th February 2016. Investigation is at the initial stage. The petitioner is the president of Jawaharlal Nehru University Students Union. His presence on the spot on 9th February 2016 has been claimed as on the basis of raw video footage of that day, 9th February 2016. The petitioner is in judicial custody. The question is, in view of the nature of serious allegations against him, the anti-national attitude which can be gathered from the material relied upon by the state should be a ground to keep him in jail." What is the legal meaning of a phrase called anti-national? How does a sitting judge of the High Court use language of this nature? I think these are issues we will have to talk about, because there's too much silence surrounding things that are happening in very important institutions and offices. As president of GNGSU, the petitioner was expected to be responsible and accountable for any anti-national event organized in the campus. Freedom of speech guaranteed to the citizens of this country under the Constitution has enough room for every citizen to follow his own ideology or political affiliation within the framework of the Constitution. While dealing with the bail application of the petitioner, it has to be kept in mind by all concerned that they are enjoying this freedom only because our borders are guarded by our armed and paramilitary forces. Our forces are protecting our frontiers in the most difficult terrain in the world, Siachen Glacier or Run of Kutch. How does my enjoyment or exercise or observance of, and this could be, you know, we could laugh at it, we could ridicule it. It's been stated by a sitting judge of the High Court. And so one dares not laugh, not because of fear of contempt, but because of fear of what is the Constitution interpretation that is being done in the courts where we have to turn for protection. And therefore, when Avinash, a student, says that he's fearful, there is good reason for that. I want to move. So what happened in the JNU case? The fact that we were attacked, the fact that one man breached security, the highest court of the land didn't see any reason to interfere with the matter. While granting bail, in fact, a condition was imposed that he will not participate in any anti-national activity. I'm not sure actively or passively. I'm not even sure what, if this bail condition was imposed on anybody, what would they do or what are they expected to do? Of course, there is no charge sheet till date. And that is what I'm saying. The purpose of invoking criminal law is not actually to take it anywhere. It's already served its purpose. The point is to both put fear in the wider community, what is called the chilling effect, and to vilify and demonize, and that demonization does not go away with time. We know the demonization of JNU happened, and others would be speaking about that. But there is, and it's played its role, and I think JNU in particular is being seen in a certain way. Perhaps Surajit has already mentioned those things, but I will just flag two cases which are actually coming up before the High Court tomorrow. With respect to appointments and with respect to admissions, all rules, procedures are being distorted, contorted in a manner as to control both the admissions and the appointments. If you can close the admission and appointments of a university, the university is as good as over, having already vilified it. I will move very quickly to what was spoken in the Ramjas incident by Mukul and by, because I had helped them with their legal processes. They were not able to get an FIR filed. And I think there is a distinction. The reason why most of JNU is contesting every single attack, whether on procedures of appointment or these kind of sedition cases, or now that they have earlier, which has been removed, the injunction of where you will protest, how you will protest, CCTV cameras all over, etc., etc., is because there is also a very strong civil liberties committed faculty, which makes a lot of difference. It enables both the students as well as the faculty to take certain positions and stance. In the Ramjas incident, despite repeated reminders that Mukul and Avinash would bear me out, they were unable to get, and I think the principal also wrote letters to the Morris Nagar SHO, they were unable to even get the FIR registered that they were attacked. The only FIR was against them. A complaint case was filed, which Avinash referred to in Tisazari, by any young person, saying that sedition should be invoked against these people. And we saw a crime branch inquiry, the result of it nobody ever saw. We don't know what is happening because these are slightly under the radar kind of operations that are conducted. So here you have the party that has been, and there was some in-house inquiry which Mukul didn't tell us about, so I have no idea what happened to that in-house inquiry, because they all did give statements. But certainly in the staff room, all teachers were not willing to put their leg out and get condemned and get isolated. And people think both of jobs and other public scrutiny, etc., that is necessarily follows these kinds of events. And I'll just mention lastly, and I see Snehita is present here. We saw from February 2016 also the pattern is the same. The roundness event was directly linked to the JNU event because it was the invite to Umar Khalid, which actually was seen by ABVP as an act of provocation, and therefore it must be halted. So there is a common pattern that they are drawing, and also what you will speak and against whom you will speak. Smir Satan was present here from the Central University of Haryana in Mahendragarh, an extremely brave lecturer. I'm sorry, you may be an assistant professor, I'm not familiar with these grades, who didn't have support of a faculty like JNU and had organized, and it's something about literature which clearly gets them right, had similarly organized a festival where Draupadi of Mahashweta Devi was to be enacted, and had read out an epilogue quoting what are the contemporary situations in which we could reflect upon Mahashweta Devi's Draupadi. And it led to some kind of neighborhood protest by people who apparently joined the army, etc., because she pointed to the kind of violations the armed forces had committed in the northeast Kashmir and in the region of Chhattisgarh Bastar. She had to face an inquiry that was constituted, a rather high level inquiry, in which, if I'm not mistaken, there were at least three retired vice chancellors. And she was asked to give an explanation for reading out an epilogue, and was then let off with a warning that in case you commit a similar act in future, they will take disciplinary action. These are cases that I've been personally involved with as a lawyer in assisting these people deal with the kind of attack we are facing. And I think the attack is quite clear. The attack is, what will you speak? What will you speak to the students? What are the ideas that will be allowed to be presented to the students? And the criminal law is being brought in very clearly to draw the boundaries of that speech. And speech that will not glorify their version of the nation state or the armed forces is now going to be bracketed in speech that would fall foul, perhaps not of the Constitution, but then it depends entirely on the judge sitting there and interpreting it, but definitely falls foul of what is permissible activity. And I think we will, in the years to come, see much, much more use of the criminal law. And we will see the criminal law being used. It's not going to go anywhere. They're not interested in filing the cases. The job has already been done by naming you the FIR, and you are going to then be harassed both institutionally and publicly in different ways. And representing such people seems to now carry its own issues and concerns. I would only end with saying that given the fact that we are in such a scenario, and given the fact that university authorities will be increasingly deploying these means, this is something that we discovered with the Ramjas group as we were trying to find a way to disentangle what was going on. I think it's very important for those of us who do intend to stand for freedom of thought, freedom of speech and expression, and use university as arenas of cultivating that kind of thought, to acquire some familiarity with the criminal law and its processes. It's not something that one should necessarily have to do in life, but since it is upon us, it would be good to know, have some familiarity, because you will have to know the enemy and its machinations to be able to deal with it. Thank you.